Welcome to the Portland Culinary Podcast and Portland Culinary Radio. I'm Stephen Shalma, your host, and I'm delighted this morning we have a special guest joining us, Anne Hubach. Did I get that right?
You did.
Anne Hubach, who is the founder of Helioterra, which is a fantastic winery that I love and excited about. So I first met you, I think, 2 years ago on an event here in Portland. I've been following your story and following your brand, and it's so great to finally sit down with you.
Thanks for inviting me.
Okay, so when did Helioterra first start?
So Helioterra first started in 2009. I had been making wine for other wineries around the valley for the previous 8 years and decided it was time to go out on my own. And so bought a few tons of Pinot Noir and Syrah, was off to the races.
Okay, so you said 2009, so it's 2017. So is this 8 or 9?
Well, 9th vintage, my friend.
Okay, so by my math, this is your 8th year in existence.
Correct.
But this fall will be your 9th vintage.
That's right.
Your 9th harvest, your 9th fall, taking grapes and beginning the journey of turning them into wine.
That's right.
Because you guys, winemakers think differently than us.
We think in vintage years. Just like tax accountants think in tax years, right?
There you go. Okay, so I'm always curious where people's journey began. So where were you born?
Sheboygan, Wisconsin.
Oh, that's too bad, because I lived in Minnesota.
Oh, honey.
So where'd you go to high school?
Sheboygan North High.
And what is the mascot there?
Well, it's the Sheboygan North Raiders.
So you probably do like the Packers.
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, how can you be from Wisconsin and not like the Packers?
I know. I lived in Minnesota for 3 years, so I like to tease whenever I encounter that. But you've been to, so Cervace is a Packers bar here in Portland.
That's
Have you
right.
been there?
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, all right. Well, we will still love your wine, even if you do like the Packers.
Everyone's got their choices.
Okay, so where did your wine journey begin?
Well, it really began, I suppose, back growing up before I even really realized where it was beginning. My family would host family dinners and events and parties, and there'd always be wine there. We had a family that I was always invited or included to try the wines with meals. A lot of times I didn't early on, and then started there. And then, of course, being in Wisconsin, there's a lot of consumption, and did some others more exploration in both in high school and college. And really, it was in college when I started getting into the combination of food and wine and flavors, and started getting really geeky on a level of tasting and understanding wines, and especially wines as they go with food.
So your college roommates must have loved you.
They absolutely did. There'd be nights that I would stay in and as my stress relief cook, and they'd come home and there'd be like 5-course dinner waiting at 2 a.m.
And you would pair your food with a wine?
Yes. Yeah.
Because when I talk to brewers, I also do the Portland Beer Podcast, you know, they are drinking beer early on, whereas when I talk to winemakers on the Portland Culinary Podcast, they're drinking wine early on. And that just kind of, I'm sure Wisconsin College, you drank some beer.
Absolutely.
But you just kind of, your heart, you gravitated toward wine.
Absolutely.
So in college, what appealed to you? I mean, this is early, but if you can remember back early in your wine journey, what appealed to you about wine back then?
Well, to me, the thing that's most appealing about wine is the complexity of it, the aromatics and the flavor profiles, and how they pair really well with various foods. I mean, you can sit and have a very satisfying glass of wine, but you can have a transcendental experience when you pair that with the right food. And I was very much into cooking and the flavors that brought out, but then also exploring the differences in wines and what acidity did to food or what tannin did to food, and just how intriguing their aromatics were for the wines, too.
I love that. Okay, and you mentioned something to me about soaking off labels in college. What's up with all of that?
Yeah, so, I mean, I got pretty nerdy about it. I actually went to, like, the Kinko's or FedEx and printed off and made my own wine-tasting booklets and spiral-bound them, and then I would soak off the labels, and I would have places where I could write the vintage, the price, where I bought it, what I cooked with it, who I drank it with, and then all of our notes. And I would hand these out, actually, to friends when they came over to do the same. I was that geeky. Like, I just wanted to explore and take record and start to track what it was that I was tasting and experiencing, so that when I was looking for a specific flavor or experience, that I had a record and I could go back and learn more from my own experiences.
So hearing that story, I have zero doubt that you are destined to become a winemaker. It just, that's got to be the path. But you didn't know that then, did you?
No, no, no. And in fact, actually, I remember specifically, I was in Madison. There was a restaurant that sadly doesn't exist anymore called Pasta Pertuti, and it was one of my favorite Italian restaurants in Madison. And I was out with some friends, and I looked across the table at them, and I said, you know, I think I'm going to make wine someday. And they're like, I bet you will. And I said, I have no freaking idea how I'm going to do that, but that just sounds like a really cool thing to do.
And just because we're in Oregon, what did you say recently Oregon was recognized
as? Oh, yeah, the Wine Enthusiast magazine just recognized Oregon, actually specifically the Willamette Valley, as the number one wine growing region in the world.
And some people may say, oh, there's other parts. But for sure, Oregon is one of the top five places in the world for wine, in my opinion.
Yeah, and specifically Pinot Noir.
Correct. Although we make a lot of other good
wines. We make a ton of good wines.
What, I mean, more than 60 varieties of grapes are grown here in Oregon.
We have a very special place here. I mean, the Northwest, if you look all the way far as southern Oregon up to eastern Washington and everything in between, we have just about every microclimate with maybe the exception of the super, super hot. But we can grow just about any grape that's known on the planet here within the Northwest.
And there's a lot of different wines grown. Okay, but so Oregon's awesome, but you're in Wisconsin, and Oregon's not even on your wine radar at this point, right?
Not at all.
Doesn't even exist yet.
No.
You have no idea the treasure you're about to find.
No, there's at the time there was one winery just outside of Madison called Wollersheim that had been around for a long time, and I did visit that winery a few times, and you know, they grew a few hybrid grapes there, and then they were bringing fruit in from California, and I was like, "Oh, that's pretty neat, but Wisconsin doesn't really seem like a place to make wine to me." But also, it wasn't still on my purview yet. And my undergraduate at University of Wisconsin-Madison was in geology and environmental studies. And I got a job working for a national environmental nonprofit. And they said, okay, we're launching this program in 9 cities across the U.S. Pick 2. And I said, well, I said to myself, Northwest seems great. I've never been there. And so I put Seattle and Portland as my 2 choices. And a few weeks later, they called me up and said, hey, we want to offer you a job and we want to put you in Portland. What do you think? I said, I'm packing my car. So I moved out here, not knowing what was about to happen.
Okay, but there's an interesting little side journey you mentioned to me that just, so you'd finished school.
Yep.
To really have a career in geology, you need a master's.
Right.
You weren't ready for that.
Right.
So you were thinking about, what were you thinking about?
I was thinking about culinary school. And I actually was very close to enrolling in culinary school in Chicago and had gone down there and interviewed 2 different schools and was in the process of, actually, it was kind of funny because there was one day, and this was sort of maybe a little destiny, there was one day that I went down to Chicago and I both interviewed for the nonprofit job that then landed me in Portland, also interviewing the culinary school that I was entertaining on the same day. And it was literally like the paths started at that one particular day on a hot summer spring day in, when was that, like May of 99.
And so you could have gone either, you might have ended up being a chef, maybe. Or a restaurateur, who knows, but something, maybe that journey, go to culinary school, different things emerge.
Right.
But you end up going to Portland and eventually end up becoming a winemaker.
That's right.
Okay, so what year did you move to Portland?
99.
Yeah. And okay.
I'm almost a native Oregonian at this point.
Almost, yes. We'll take it. Okay, and so then, now you're working for a nonprofit in
right.
What field?
I was working for an environmental nonprofit, but actually I was doing major donor fundraising.
Okay, but in the environmental world?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, but now you're in Portland.
Yep.
What happens, where does wine in you then pick up the path?
Well, so I moved out here and I didn't know a single person. When they said, we want to move you out to Portland, I said, that's great. I was 22 and I was like, well, I'll go anywhere once, you know, if it doesn't work, I'll pick up and move somewhere else. So I moved out here. I mean, literally the only person who I knew, quote unquote, was my dad's college roommate, who I didn't know.
And you know how uncommon that is from the Midwest. I live in the Midwest for 3 years, and there's people that I knew that had never left the state of Minnesota.
Right.
And they were proud of that.
Right.
Some people didn't want to leave St. Cloud.
Right.
And so in the Midwest, it's common to stay in your state or in your city, even worse. So you go to your city, you go to college and come back to your city. So for you to be like, hey, I'll go somewhere, you're wired different than a lot of Midwesterners.
That's true. And I'm grateful for that. But also, I knew that I wanted to go try other places. And so when I moved out here, I, like I said, didn't know a single person. And so I'm not a sit at home. I'm not a TV watcher. And I was like, I need to fill my time. So I looked around and started to realize that I had landed in this wine region. And because, you know, 20 years ago, almost no Oregon wineries were, we'll call it exporting, you know, shipping their wines and selling their wines in other states, especially not the upper Midwest. So I didn't really even realize in my own wine journey that there was wine being made out here. So I got this job on the weekends, pouring wine at Tualatin and Estate Vineyards in their tasting room. And that was such a cool experience. It opened my eyes to not only the Oregon wine scene, but just this whole community of people that exists here in the Northwest and in the wine industry that's here. And the light bulb started going off with fierce ferocity that was pointing my life in a slightly different direction. I did still end up in the nonprofit and public policy world for a few years. I actually worked in politics for a few years. But I really always had so much fun on that weekend job, and then started to take that a little bit more seriously towards 2000, 2001, and actually started taking some classes at Chemeketa and also at just other wine bars around town, as in like wine appreciation classes. And
so Chemeketa is a pretty cool community college.
Absolutely.
South of here.
Yeah.
A lot of people go, Chemeketa, what is that? I can't spell it, but I've learned to say it because I've heard it so much.
Right.
And now they are very big in wine.
They're awesome. They have a program that is really geared not only towards winemaking, but also the business of wine and in cool climate grape growing. And they've built an entire winery and vineyard and facility and laboratory specifically to help educate the next realm of wine entrepreneurs and employees of the industry. So they have a 10-acre vineyard that grows I don't know how many, but quite a few different grapes that can be grown in the Willamette Valley. They have a small-scale winery. They produce their own brand. The students take care of the vineyards, and it's really a great program.
So that's now. Mm-hmm. But back then, they had classes. So what were some of the classes you took back then?
So I took, like, a wine chemistry class. I took a winery planning class. I took a Spanish class. Spanish in the vineyard is a huge deal. And in the winery, and anything from, in the beginning it was more like wine knowledge classes, wine appreciation, wine of the world.
So you started out with those classes,
and then got more technical. We talked about like wine flaws, the wine production, the wine chemistry, all of those that are more technical that help lead more to a production career.
And so every class led you to the next class, and it continued to resonate with you.
And I continued to work within the industry. And then I thought, I need to do this. I need to get out of this public policy work that I'm doing. And I told you, some of that get out of was predicated upon 9/11 happening. I was at the time a director of a nonprofit that was raising money for good public policy ideas for the state of Oregon. And that was great fun, but also that was great difficulty after 9/11 happened to raise money for good ideas for the state of Oregon, because people's focus changed dramatically at that point.
And that also, that wasn't your passion, because that's not geology.
It's not geology.
And that's not wine.
Nope.
And so you were kind of confronted, now what?
Well, so at that point, I decided, you know, I've taken enough of these wine classes. I think this is something that it's worth taking a shot. And so I went out, knocked on doors, and talked to a lot of different winemakers and wineries. And, you know, I kind of didn't stop talking and knocking on doors until one of them opened the door wide enough that I had a job. And that was Eric Homaker and he at the time was building the Carlton Winemaker Studio, which for the Northwest was one of the first of its kind of a shared production facility for many smaller brands to produce their wines under one roof.
So it's a place, back in the day, if I had a small winery that I wanted to make wine, I could go and use that space with a number of winemakers. We kind of all use the space. It's available. Maybe get a little bit of shared knowledge, et cetera.
Correct. Yep.
Okay, so had you...
It was a great place to be a fly on the wall for the first year.
So were you aware that you'd found your calling at that point?
Not probably. I mean, yes and no. I was... The scratch was getting itched, and soon it was something that I couldn't deny. And at that point, after that first harvest was over, I was considerably humbled, but yet at the same time... ready for the next opportunity and the next challenge.
So what was your job there at the Carlton Winemaker Studio, your first year, 02, right. What was your job?
just cellar grunt. I was doing everything from cleaning tanks to sorting grapes to scrubbing toilets. I mean, I did everything that it took to get the grapes in the door and made into wine.
And your first job was for the harvest of O2.
Correct.
And so you have gone from geology work, public policy, all those things paid the bills, and now your bills are being paid by wine.
For that season.
Well, I understand,
yeah.
But that's a huge shift.
It's a huge shift, absolutely.
So what? Did you love it? Did you hate it? What was your first harvest like?
It was one of the most challenging things I'd ever done. And I didn't realize and I don't think most people realize until you get into it or till you see it, just how physical and messy. I mean, there were days that my Carhartts, I'd get home and they would stand on their own because they were so sticky and wet. It was just, I mean, it's the glamorous, not so glamorous side of wines that it's, grapes are really sticky and there's lots of bugs and it's messy. And I was wet from, you know, my knees down most days and, you know, sticky grape juice in my hair and still loving it. It was great.
So were you were exhausted.
Oh, yeah.
Many days.
Oh, yeah.
When the harvest is over, were you fulfilled?
Absolutely.
Yeah, because people that love making wine, the exhaustion and the brutal work of it, because some people don't realize it's brutal work, it doesn't deter them.
No, that's
when,
true.
When the wine's in the barrels and the mess is cleaned up, they feel fulfilled, and that was your experience.
And that's like listening to the best sonata that brings you just inner peace.
That's a beautiful analogy. Okay, so that was the O2 harvest. So then what's next in your wine journey?
So from there...
No, I just occurred to something's occurred to me. I'm an amazing at math. So you did the O2 harvest as a cellar grunt.
Mm-hmm.
The O9 harvest was your first year for Helioterra.
Right.
That's a 7-year gap.
Yes.
That's interesting. Okay, so what happened in those 7 years?
Well, I dedicated myself to learning the craft of making wine and went out to find as many jobs and experiences that I could with a lot of top-notch winemakers in Oregon. So I actually worked for 5 different wineries in those 7 years.
And harvest is over in 02.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to pay the bills.
Mm-hmm.
So did you stick with wine?
I did.
So in 03, how many different W-2s roughly did you have?
About 6. I said yes to every opportunity, and there were about a few that came to me and many that I sought out, anywhere from filing papers to bottling wines to... You name it. If there was a job to taste it, more tasting room, if there was a job to be done, I was doing it.
Because you wanted to be in wine.
No question.
Okay. I love it. So when did the idea first occur to you that maybe you should have your own winery? Any ideas?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it was at a point where I invested 7 or 8 years into other people's wines.
And so you started out as a cellar rat, you said.
Mm-hmm.
Then a cellar grunt.
Yeah.
Then
cellar master, assistant winemaker, consulting winemaker. And I had reached this point that I gained a lot of valuable experience from the winemakers that I had worked for. And I'm indebted to each one of those experiences. I worked anywhere from small family-owned wineries to some of the largest wineries in the state. And every experience taught me a lot. And I got to a point when I was winemaker at Apolloni, and they're a small family-owned winery. They make about 8,000 cases now. At the time when I started with them, we were only at about 2,500, 3,000.
And what years were you there?
I was there 06 through 09.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, I like them. I'm a fan of them.
Yep. And actually, in 09, I was both consulting on their wines and starting my project, starting Helioterra in the same year.
Okay, so your first Helioterra harvest, we'll get
09.
To the name. We'll
yeah.
get to the name in a second, but was 09. But when in 09, that's fall, when the harvest is, when in 09 did you say, you know what, I'm going to make wine for my own winery myself?
Right, so it was probably pretty early on in the year, and it was one of those things where I adore Apollonis. I still buy grapes from them, but I had reached a point where I was ready for the next challenge within my career, and I was looking around, and I didn't really want to go work for a larger winery, and that's where most of the job opportunities were at the time. And I knew that from past experiences that I had made world-class wines myself, we had sent things out for scores that got well placed and things of that nature, and so I looked around the landscape and decided, okay, these aren't the jobs that I want. This isn't going to be fulfilling. This isn't going to satisfy my need for my next challenge. And so I decided it was time to take a gamble on myself.
Okay. And so to do that, you have to buy grapes.
Correct.
Your first harvest, how many grapes did you buy for your winery?
So I bought 6 tons of grapes.
That's a lot of grapes.
It is. Well, it is and it's not.
Well, six tons sounds like a lot to me.
6 tons is, you know, a car is about a ton. So, you know, it's like 6 cars worth of grapes. That's a lot. It is. And, you know, that produced about 400 cases of wine.
Yeah, so where'd you get the money for those 6 tons of grapes?
Well, that whole gamble on myself thing was literally like looking around, and I didn't want to ask for money from my family. I wanted to do this on my own. And so I pulled equity out of the mortgage of my house.
That is a serious gamble on yourself.
That is a serious gamble on myself. That is what is the most financially rich asset that I have at the time, and it was our house, and I literally pulled half the equity out of our mortgage and bought my grapes.
Okay, so and then that harvest, you're working basically 2 full-time jobs.
Correct.
You're making wine for Apolloni, and you're making wine for yourself.
At 2 different locations.
So really, you did bootstrap your way to a better life.
I did. Absolutely. This was, I'm doing this and I'm doing this on my own and this is how I want it done. And I'm doing everything that I can do to make that happen.
Okay. And the way wine works, you start making it in harvest, but it's not actually done till later.
Right.
So you said 400 cases. What were the kinds of wines you made that first year?
So that first year was Pinot Noir and Syrah. And actually what I did when I pulled that equity out, it wasn't enough just to buy those first 6 tons. It was enough to buy those first 6 tons and bottle it. And also buy the next year's grapes because I knew that I was going to be into the next harvest before I had any wine available to sell. So I tried to set myself up to succeed out of the start and pulled out a year and a half worth of budget and then started smallish at 400 cases so that then the following year I could roll into, it was 660, and I added in Pinot Blanc.
The first year, the harvest of 09, which you end up making is... 300 cases of Pinot Noir.
Correct.
And 100 cases of Syrah.
Correct.
Why those two first time out of the chute?
Well, first and foremost, Pinot Noir is the queen of Oregon and Willamette Valley, specifically. Even that said, though, 60% of the fruit grown in the Willamette Valley is Pinot Noir. The rest are a number of great grapes. Syrah, just because I loved it. I wanted to be making a Syrah. I wanted to make a very subtle, graceful, elegant Pinot Noir, and I wanted to make a little bit richer, robust Syrah. And so I wanted, you know, I was setting my course to have a nice spectrum of wines. Pinot Blanc was the next up. So I knew that I wanted to have at least a white, a Pinot, and a big red. And so this was setting the stage for, you know, a diversified portfolio of wine offerings from Helioterra.
So your first year, you were already making wine that would help you get to your third and fourth year.
Correct.
Okay, so I've heard Pinot Noir referred to as the heartbreak grape.
Yes.
Why is that?
Well, Pinot Noir can really only grow well, in my opinion, in cool climates. It doesn't do well in hot climates because it gets sunburned very easily. It's got a very thin skin. Also, as a result of that, it really is one of these grapes that cannot be mechanized or it can't be very easily. You have to have hand-grown fruit. The canopy is susceptible to some diseases. The canopy, the grape, the leaves, right? Every particular Pinot Noir, if you're going to be creating world-class, high-quality Pinot, has to be touched by human hand at least 7 times per year during the growing season for getting the best quality fruit. And very little of those steps can be mechanized without doing some level of damage to the fruit. So that in and of itself is challenging. And then because we're growing a red grape in a cool climate, you also, and in Oregon, of course, as we know, that liquid sunshine that comes in our wet season, as we just came out of our wettest winter in record almost, you have to bring your grapes in before it starts raining. And part of why that's important is in grapes, if the rain comes, they start to dilute. If, you know, that fruit takes up that moisture through the roots and through the leaves. But not only that, but because those skins are so thin that if they get enough rain moisture, they can actually swell to the point of splitting. And the minute that happens, you have any mold and bacteria that can come, and you may end up losing your crop.
Okay, so it's hard to grow and get it right, but then to actually take a grape and make a good Pinot Noir is not easy.
Not easy.
And you chose that as one of your first two wines right out of the chute.
I like a good challenge.
Okay, so you put it in barrels.
Yeah.
In 09.
Yep.
French oak barrels.
Correct.
Okay. And then roughly when did you put it in bottles?
Roughly about 12 months later.
Okay. And, you know, winemakers, they taste along the way, you know, but you're still not opening a bottle of wine when it's all done yet.
No.
Okay. So it's in barrels for about a year. Then you put it in bottles. Roughly how long was it in bottles? Your first Pinot.
It was in bottle a couple of months before I released it out to the world.
So we're looking roughly November 2010.
Right.
So it's been about 14 months.
Uh-huh.
You open that first bottle. What do you find?
It was pretty darn good.
And how did that feel?
It was great. It was fantastic. It was really, I mean, that first, unlike in other beverage industries where there's a quick turn and you know very quickly how that product is going to turn out, that's not the case with wine. Even in white wines, you know, you still have a few months, you're still a minimum like about 6 months in before you get to really try that. And here in reds, or like the big reds that I do, are a year and a half or more before you get to that point. It's a very huge exercise in patience, which I'm not that great at. But in wine, you have to. It teaches you that you have to wait for what you really want.
So I'm going to skip ahead in time briefly, then come back in time. So hang in there with me. So your Syrah was in barrels a little bit longer.
Correct. Okay. About a year and a half.
So when did you open your first Syrah then? That was probably spring of 11?
Correct.
And what was that like?
That was awesome. It was really great. And the two wines are very different. I mean, Pinot is more pretty and elegant, red fruited and nice acid. And Syrah is more about this like lovely cocoa powdery type texture and a richness and a more in the fruit that I choose. It's more like this like dusty blueberry characteristic that comes through on the aroma and a much bigger mouthfeel. And that's, you know, I make these two very distinctly different wines because they play very two distinct different roles. It's very intentional, but very rewarding to have these two wines taste as they should, but also be really as they should, you know, their varietal typicity. To have them taste the way that I intended them to go into when you first buy your first grapes.
That's awesome. And I want to go back in time, back to November of 10.
Mm-hmm.
You've opened your first bottle. It worked. It's good. Success.
Right.
Now you have 300 cases.
Right.
So how many cases in a bottle for those that don't know?
There are, how many bottles in a case?
Yes, exactly. Sorry.
Not very many. There's 12 bottles in a case.
So I don't know what 300 times 12 is, but that's a lot.
Right.
So you've got a lot of bottles now.
Correct.
What happens next? Where do you sell it? What do you do with it?
How do you sell it, right? Yeah. I was scared of that moment because then it's not only something that it satisfies me, but I've got to convince other people that it's satisfying to them. So I started throwing it in the back of my car, and I made appointments at like people at like my favorite restaurants around town or retailers and tried to get in the doors of places like Whole Foods and New Seasons, which is a long process. Went to bottle shops, went anywhere that anyone would take an appointment to taste me, and even those that wouldn't. And I would just stand there until I could get the card or the name or the phone number of who I needed to talk to. And I was literally selling it out of the back of my car.
I'm Ann, and I made this wine.
Pretty much. You want to try it?
I applaud that entrepreneurial spirit. That is incredible. That's true startup activity right there.
That's right.
Oh, man, that's amazing. Okay, so at this point, I want to talk about the name. So Helioterra is the name of your primary winery. You have a couple other brands. You have Wonelli, of course.
Yep.
But Helioterra, talk to me about the name. Where did it come from? I love the story.
Yeah, so in naming and branding, you need, I believe, something that's really, it tells a good story, that has some meaning. I really didn't want to put my name on the label. I wanted something that is a little, it's still very much about me, but something that tells a better tale that's maybe more compelling to other people as well. My undergraduate was in geology, as I said. And so when I moved out here, I learned that the Oregon State gemstone, we have a state gemstone, it's called the heliolite. It's found down in far reaches of southern Oregon. It's a really cool gemstone that I drew my inspiration from that name. Heliolite is actually more commonly known as the sunstone. And helio is Greek for the word sun. And terra, that's sort of the made-up part of the name, is earth in Greek. And, of course, what do we need to grow grapes or anything for that matter but sun and earth? Maybe a little water thrown in. And I then chose also, you can't see it, listeners, but there's an ammonoid fossil on my label as the logo, and I felt that looked a little bit like the sun depicted in the earth. And then to take it one step further,
tell me the name of that fossil again.
Oh, the fossil is the ammonoid.
Ammonoid fossil. And that's the image. It's on the label.
That is the logo image. It's also on the cork.
Yep.
And then you can see the labels have a very earth tone color scheme. The Pinot Noirs are sort of a beige color. The bigger reds are an orangish color. And the white wines and rosés are all a bluish color. Heliolite actually gets influenced in its color by different trace minerals. And it can range anywhere from greenish blue to bright orange, and actually the colors of the labels are the different color spectrums that the heliolite can express.
And something I love about your brand that is near and dear to my heart is it's authentic. What I teach people is you cannot create your brand. You have to discern it. Because when people create, they just make up stuff. But if it doesn't match them, it doesn't fit them, people can smell it and it creates a disconnect because it's not authentic.
Right.
And this came right out of your love of geology background. My grandfather was a rock hound. He would go to the gem fairs and he would, Victorville, California. I had to go to all kinds of festivals with him when I was very young, and he had all these rocks and geodes. And so you honor your own story, but you've done it in such a way that you allow other people to embrace it as theirs. And for even people that don't know all of this, it just sounds cool. Helioterra.
Right.
It just sounds cool. And as I look at it, and how do you say it? Okay, now I know. Helioterra.
Right. And I grew up with the last name Ebenreiter, and I definitely didn't want something that someone couldn't pronounce or spell or say. So that was actually one of my own personal. Someone had to be able to pick up that bottle and know how to pronounce it.
Okay. And so you first harvest is March of 09.
Fall of 09.
I mean, fall of 09.
March of 09, something else happened.
That's right. What happened then?
I had my second child. So I birthed my business and my daughter in the same calendar year.
That is fantastic.
In hindsight, I was a little crazy. But at the time, it seemed like the right thing to do.
Okay. And so when did you name the business?
So the business actually almost came down to the last minute. I had made the wines. They were aging. And I needed to get my license. I was producing under someone else's license just to bring the grapes in the door. And so I knew I had it in the door. I knew I was making it. But then you don't have to declare it until the end when you bottle. And so I had to have my licenses in order by then. And so it was literally like 6 months into the process before I actually had a name.
So you put the wine, you harvest, the wine goes into barrels. We're into spring of 2010 when you finally are, okay, we're going to pick a name now.
Exactly. So hard. It was easier to name my daughter that year than it was to name the business.
That's fantastic. All right. So 400 cases your first year.
Yep.
And now about how many cases a year do you do now?
Well, so that was those two wines at 400 cases. I'm now up to 12 wines, about 3,000 cases.
3,000 cases. So that's...
It's a lot of growth.
It's a lot of growth. That's a big change.
Yeah.
What do you attribute that to?
Lots of really cool opportunities. I say that I make sort of three main pillars of wine. I do aromatic, underdog, unusual white wines. I do Pinot Noirs, and I do Rhone-style reds, Rhone being a region in France. And those are my three pillars of focus.
So a lot of winemakers, it appears that whites are kind of a throwaway for them.
Yeah, it does appear that way.
They don't get a lot of attention, get a lot of love. Artists Wine, I recently met them. They're out in the Willamette Valley. He loves making wines. That's his primary. He talks with whites, passion like most people talk about reds. But you said aromatic whites. Why that emphasis? That's not always common in winemakers.
No, I love the whites that are super expressive in the glass. And frankly, many people will say that actually... Early to market aromatic whites are some of the most challenging to make because if there's any small amount of flaws within those wines, they will show themselves because these are more focused, they're more slightly more delicate. You have to be able to get them to a finished point where they taste complete within a very short time frame. And I had 2 years experience when I was working for Joe Dobbs where I was only making white wines. And I had a really great experience being able to make just about every white grape grown in the state of Oregon. And I was fermenting anything from small barrel fermentations up to very large tank fermentations and used a variety of different yeasts and techniques and ferment temperatures. So I was really able to hone in my craft of making white wines. And I take a lot of attention. My harvest staff every year, I think, hates me because we have normally about three times as many white fermentations to manage as we do reds, even though whites only comprise about 40% of my production. Not only, that's almost half, right? But It's about half the production, but three times as much work to manage during harvest season. And that's all for the quest of making the most aromatic and balanced and lively white wines that we can do.
I love it. Okay, so tell me if I got this right. Aromatic whites, really great Pinots.
And that includes Pinot Rosé.
Pinot Rosé, yes. I had that at Pour 503.
Yeah.
It was amazing. Shout out to Cellar 503. It was a great event.
It was.
And I love Cellar 503. And then big reds from with Rhone region grapes.
Correct.
Those are the three kinds.
Yep.
And if I where can we get your wine?
So you can get it across Oregon at most high-end retailers, bottle shops, and restaurants.
Okay.
You can find it also in 11 other states, plus Canada and Japan.
Wow. That's from 400 cases till now, 11 states, Canada, Japan, and across Oregon. How did that come to be?
Well, there's a lot of work. You know, once you make a certain amount of wine, we're so lucky that we live where we do because there's so many amazing beverages that are made here and just wine specifically. But that said, there's also a huge amount of competition here. So it's pretty easy to sell about your first 1,000 cases in your own home market. But once you grow above that, you really have to start looking outside to other markets. So, you know, I'm in places like Wisconsin and Minnesota where I have lots of friends and family that I get to go stay and visit and that go and buy my wines and are proud of that. And so how does that happen? Well, you know, you start to make enough wine and then you figure out you got to sell it. And not only sell it out of the back of your car anymore, but now you have to sell it to other places so that you have more distribution and also help propel your story and your mission further. So I went first to the places that I had representation of friends or family, places that I want to go anyways. That seems like the natural fit, right? Kill two birds with one stone. You get to hang out with your parents or your best friend from college and, you know, sell some wine at the same time. It's a pretty good deal.
So that's why I can get Helioterra in the Twin Cities.
That's exactly right. Yep. I get to go stay with my aunt and uncle.
That's
and then
brilliant.
Next, you know, you look at the places where you want to go.
And so part of it is just you get in the car, get on a plane and go sell it.
Absolutely.
And just make it happen.
Yep.
What role has social media played?
Social media definitely plays a pretty big role. It's one of those, it's a catch-22. It's something that it's monetarily free, but it's not free in your time. But it's definitely accessible to any person that's out there. Everyone, if they want, can have a Twitter account and a Instagram account and Facebook account and, you know, using that as a tool. I would definitely say that there's at least two markets that I'm in right now that happened as a result of social media, that friends that happened to be in the wine industry from, you know, my high school days saw that I was also making wine and said, hey, I got to introduce you to some people. And that's how things happen. And a lot of networking, you know, getting out in front of folks and writers and bloggers and podcasters and talking to people about your story. Sometimes things just happen.
Yeah, you have to tell your story. And if you tell your story, good things happen.
Right.
I teach that storytellers win and storytelling works.
There you go.
Okay, so speaking of that, so you're going to be traveling mid-May through mid-July, roughly 90 days. Not the whole time, but a lot of it.
Yep.
And most of that travel is professional.
Correct.
Why are you getting on a plane and headed out? Why do that?
Right. Well, you know, and I just got back from travel. I was 2 weeks in Toronto and Wisconsin, and now I'm heading back to Wisconsin and to Texas. And these are sales trips. This is, you know, the wines don't, unfortunately, they don't just sell themselves. You know, I still, just like I have the luxury of being here in Oregon in a great place that we do wonderful, have a wonderful support of the beverage industry here, I still get out and talk to people and actively sell my wine and go sit at bars and restaurants and talk to the wine buyers and the gatekeepers and whatnot and the storytellers. And I do the same in all of those places too. So I get on a plane literally to go and stop in all of these restaurants and retailers to tell my story to them so that they have that next level of knowledge and empowerment to go and tell their customers the story. So it just keeps on rippling out.
I love it. Okay, so thinking of next steps, always like to curious where people are headed.
Yep.
Any plans or hopes for a tasting room?
Absolutely. Yeah, I definitely want to have more representation that we can tell our story directly to our customers and have a place to invite people to come. It's in the works. It's not yet happening, but details coming soon.
So maybe, how about, I guess, how about is the hope to have a tasting room here in the Portland area in the next 2 years?
That's a pretty good guess.
All right. Yeah. I like that. Okay. Well, we will, when that happens, we'll have to come do a podcast there and celebrate that step of the journey.
Won't that be awesome?
That will be. And I have no doubt. I mean, it sometimes take longer than we think. Maybe it's 3 years, but I have no doubt that it will happen because you've continued to build and put the work in. Because not only do you know how to make great wine, I've had your wine, it's amazing, but then you also know how to build a business and you're willing to have the tenacity and put the work in to put it together, which is a powerful combination. Okay. So, what does it take to be a good winemaker?
Well, to be a good... Anyone can ferment beverages. I mean, the fermenting is the fun, easy part. Making a good bottle of wine or glass of wine is the hard part. I think the ability to discern flavors and aromas and also to be able to detect what's going on. I mean, wine is a living, breathing thing. There's microorganisms that are like yeast, you know, the yeasts are eating your sugars and you're turning it into alcohol but other things happen along the way. There's yeast, good bacteria, there's also bad bacteria, and being able to have the breadth of experience to be able to identify what's going on in your wines and shepherd it along, but also being able to create wines of balance and know what techniques to use to make good picking choices of when you're bringing your grapes into the winery, how to create and ferment balanced and pretty wines, and know when they're good, when to stop. You know, you can overwork a wine, you could do very little work and hit it right on the head, but kind of being able to bring that wine to fruition and know how to get it to where you want it to be and then capture it at its peak is a big challenge.
Okay, so summarizing what I heard, attention to detail and having a good palate, being able to taste what the heck is going on.
Yes.
Okay. What does it take to have... So making wine is one thing. Having a successful winery, successful business is another. What a couple things stand out to you needed to have a successful winery on the business side?
Right. So... Absolutely, bar none, you have to be able to sell, or you have to be smart enough to hire someone who knows how to sell, because it is a highly competitive field, and it doesn't sell itself, and if you can't go out selling, or if you don't want to sell on your own, you absolutely have no use making it. I like to say to people, you know, you can keep buying it, I will keep making more, but if they're not buying it, I can't keep making it. So you absolutely need to know how to sell, and you have to be smart about how you're spending your money. You have to take good opportunities when they come and pass on mediocre opportunities when they come as well, because there's tons of opportunities for different projects, but it's very easy to get distracted.
So you get lots of opportunities for things to be involved as far as a winemaker in a winery. And you have to figure out which ones to say yes to and which ones to say no to.
Yes.
Okay, because some will lead you probably to be distracted and broke, and others will lead to growth.
Right.
That sounds like a dangerous skill set. Man, you should teach a class just on that.
Some of that is common sense, and we both know common sense doesn't always come naturally.
Yeah, common sense ain't common is how I like to put it.
That's right.
Okay, so now we're going to drink some of your wines, which I'm really excited about, and... Yep. I know, having been around a wine community and wine fans, that a lot of wine fans, when I'm sometimes, you know, at the table or at a booth or at a tasting room, it seems like some of the wine fans think they know more than the winemaker, mm-hmm. which always makes me scratch my head. It's like, no, I don't think actually you do know more than the winemaker. And I know that sometimes there's a hesitation on the part of winemaker sides to suggest food pairings, because sometimes if a person's an experienced wine fan, they actually have really good ideas and they don't need yours. But the approach I take is I want to know just a little bit. So if someone that's listening to this podcast that doesn't know much about wine or food, so you've graciously agreed to throw out just a couple few pointers for
sure.
Those of us that are novices. And those of you listening to this podcast, you probably know better suggestions, and that's A-okay if you're really experienced with wine. But we're going to start with your Pinot Blanc. So I'll drink, and you talk to us about this wine.
Okay, so Pinot Blanc. This is my flagship white wine. Like I said earlier, I've been making this since 2010. This is a wine that has just a lot of complexity, but it also has bright acidity. I like to push the envelope on the acidity of this wine in specific part so that it pairs well with food, right? So this, to me, goes great with a lot of seafood, especially like prawns and scallops and the lighter, sort of more flaky white fish. It goes great with like a cream sauce pasta, wonderful with the spring vegetables and summer vegetables, especially with maybe a little bit of citrus.
So I could do like a goat cheese salad with some greens, some goat cheese, throw in some orange segments or something like that.
And this would go great.
Some blueberries on it, a little bit of balsamic.
Because this has a lot of richness, as you can taste right now. Like, the mid-palate has a lot of weight. I do a portion of this in neutral barrel, and then I stir the lees, so this wine has a lot of mid-palate texture. So it's light and delicate, and it's very focused in its acidity, but it also has a lot of nice weight and texture from that neutral barrel impact and that lees, the lees being the yeast in the wine. And so this is a very textural wine that can stand up to a lot of different food options.
It's beautiful. I love it.
Thank you.
You're right. And spring, summer, it's just, to me, perfect spring, summer wine. Throw something light on the grill. Like you said, some fish. I mean, have friends over.
Yep. Okay. This particular one did get gold at the San Francisco International Wine Competition.
Congratulations for
Thanks.
That. And the one we're drinking is your 2015.
That's
but
correct.
But each year you make a Pinot Blanc.
And I think each year I get better and better at it. I've now made this wine for 6-7 years, and even prior to my own experience, made it for other wineries. And I get even more and more detailed every year that I make this.
Okay. I love that. That is great. Okay. Now, 2014 Pinot Noir.
Right. Okay. Well, as we said, the heartbreak grape.
Yes.
Subtle, elegant, seductive. Pinot is, I'd like to make Pinot with a little bit more red fruited notes. I'd like to have a nice amount of tannin, but not too distracting. And what that means from a food perspective is a pretty like red cherry and maybe cola, but also skirting a bit of an earthiness, you know. So the classic pairings with Pinot Noir are two things that we do great here in Oregon, mushrooms and salmon.
Okay, so if you don't know what to do with your Pinot Noir, just figure out some mushrooms and salmon and you'll be great.
Yep.
And if you do know what to do with it, if you do know what to do with Pinot Noir, I would highly encourage you to get some of this. The nose on this is incredible.
Thank you. So this is a combination of 5 different vineyard sites that I work with. It's all native spontaneous fermentation. I keep everything completely separate to the end and then blend across the entire cellar. The wine that you have, this is my Willamette Valley 2014. I do make a few blends that are more reserve or single vineyard tiers. This is the cross-section of my cellar. So we just had the flagship white. This is my flagship red of my production.
And this is what we'd find every year. Wine changes vintage to vintage, but
yep.
You're making a Pinot Noir that's similar to this every year.
That's correct. But I always have to respect Mother Nature. So every vintage to vintage, I change up how I pick my fruit, not the sites. I have the same block, same sites, but how I choose to bring the fruit in, and then how I choose to use that grape in the cellar.
And when to bring it in.
When to bring it in, how to bring it in, what the chemistry and the ripeness and the flavors are that I'm looking for.
And that's the art and science of winemaking.
Right. Well,
it takes both.
And I think the one thing that we didn't really talk about is that in that production side of it, I work with about 12 different vineyards across Oregon and Washington, but I work with the same growers, same blocks, year after year, and I'm in the vineyard about once a week for the growing season, and we walk the rows together, and we talk about what's going on in the fruit to figure out what techniques need to happen within the growing of my block so I get the results that I want, so they're happy. So I'm happy as a winemaker, and they're happy selling the highest quality fruit. And then I make the picking choices.
That's a lot of commitment.
It is.
But
there really are no bad vineyard days.
Well, I can just see in my mind's eye you walking in a vineyard as the grapes are growing, you know, in the middle of summer. Probably happier than a pig in mud.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, come on. You get to drive around the Willamette Valley, A, beautiful, B, often sunny and wonderful weather, and you get to go talk with growers, talk about grapes, when it's closer to the season, pick the grapes, and right before you pick, you also have half the vineyards that have great blackberry vines, so you get to pick berries, too.
I do love me some blackberries. Okay, so the third wine that you brought this morning is Morvedre.
That's right.
That's a little bit different of a grape. Talk to us about that.
It is, and that's part of why I brought this, because it's a little bit more unusual. Most people don't know this. It is a classic grape that's grown in the Rhone in France. It normally gets blended with grapes like Syrah and Grenache. In fact, people talk about GSM blends. That stands for Grenache, Syrah, Morvedre. Morvedre is not often done as a standalone wine, as 100%. It wants, you know, you've seen these wine grape charts from the lightest and the most delicate to the most tannic and beastly, and Morvedre is on the bottom of that spectrum. It wants to be super tannic, really astringent, very big and bold.
So you'd mentioned that this is Rhone. So Rhone is a region in France.
Yep.
well, that grape is grown there, but now it's also grown here in the Northwest.
It's also grown in the Northwest. It's also grown in Spain. There it's called Mataro, or Monastrell. And so this particular grape wants to be this bigger wine. In that GSM blend, Syrah tends to be a very fleshy, very generous grape. Grenache is a very aromatic grape, and Mourvèdre is a very tannic grape. So you kind of can see how those blends, those Côte Rhône blends come together, where you have, you know, one piece of like fleshy, you know, mouthfeel, one piece of aromatics, one piece of texture, structure come together in a rough blend, right?
But this wine is...
is not that.
It's all Mourvèdre.
100% Mourvèdre. It's also 100% very, very evocative and much more subtle, because I get these grapes up in eastern Washington. It's a single vineyard called Heart of the Hill in the Red Mountain area. Then I bring them down to Oregon. And
that's a small AVA.
It's a teeny AVA. You can drive across it in 10 minutes. It's like the teeniest in the entire Northwest. And I literally will drive 4 hours each way just to go up there and look at these grapes and to kick the dirt with Scott Williams, the grower, because he's awesome and has an amazing ability to grow fruit. But this... I not only do I then bring this down from Washington, I pick it pretty early because I don't want it to be this like really overripe, rich fruit bomb wine. I want it more a little bit more restrained. But then I also put my Pinot Noir maker hat on, and I treat this a little bit more gently. So I don't want a ton of extraction. I'm not going for this tannic, beastly wine. And so, again, use spontaneous fermentation techniques, very minimal manipulation on the fermentation. I don't do a lot of punch down, therefore not a lot of extraction of the skin tannin. And then I age it for a full year and a half, on the lees in neutral barrels. So this doesn't see any new oak influence either.
Wow.
I really want just like the pure expression of the terroir and of this grape variety to come out. So it's 100% Mourvèdre from that single vineyard, Heart of the Hill in Red Mountain.
I mean, like you said, it's very enticing. It's very enticing. Okay, so for novices, what would be a suggestion for pairing this with food? Some people want their wine just 503 and a winemaker who, like, she just wants her wine just by herself. She wants wine without food, but I like to have both. I like sometimes
Just
a glass of wine. Sometimes there's the magic when you have the right pairing.
Yep.
And that's where I kind of understand winemakers' hesitancy, because you want to give wine fans the freedom to come up with an unconventional pairing that works for them.
Right.
And if you like this food and this wine and it works for you, go for it.
Right. Like, I'm not going to tell a vegetarian that this wine goes great with lamb, even though it does.
Okay, but kind of broad strokes, what do you do with this?
So, okay, we're going into summer season. This goes great with, like, the red meats on the grill. It also is an amazing, like, braising, you know, like a pot of braised vegetables or, you know, a roast. Mourvèdre goes great, great, great with lamb or some of the more unusual things like rabbit. It's a kind of more of a beastly wine.
And so you can cook beasts with it.
You can cook beasts with it.
I do a pepper bacon brie grilled peach burger.
Ooh,
for my kids.
Heck yes.
And this would go fantastic with this because it would hold up to those strong flavors.
Yep.
And when you grill the peach, it kind of works like the tomato.
Yep.
And then I put the brie on right on the burger and pepper bacon, and it's phenomenal. And this would go great with that for me.
Okay, so when you're having your next barbecue, I'm coming. I'll bring the Mourvèdre. You bring the burger.
There you go. And if someone's hearing this and says, I don't like that pairing, that's the beauty of wine, is you can find the food pairing that works for you.
Right.
And that's kind of the joy of it, is you fall in love with a wine like this, that standalone, not as a common grape, winemaker's heart is right there in the glass, and then you find the food pairing that works for you.
Yep.
I love it.
Amen. And it's really great to see how wines evolve, too, and how across the span of a meal, you can have a few different options and see how it pairs with different things. Like, this would not be a great cheese wine, in my opinion. But that said, there's probably some, like, super aged, like, Gouda with some nice little crystalline bits to it that would go really great. Or, like, I don't know why, I just thought of, like, there's a duck prosciutto that I've had that this would go great with. And, you know, you can try different things. And that's sort of the beauty of pairing, is like, ooh, I really love this combo and not as much this. This is, as much as I don't tend to care for, like, the chocolate red wine pairing, this would be one of those candidates. I think the bigger reds and super, like, of course, ones like this that are a little bit more rich in flavor and aroma, I think, do stand well, especially up to that, like, bittersweet chocolates.
Yep. This wine has just a lot of depth, a lot of character. I love it.
Thanks.
All right. Well, we drank the wines. We told your story. And it's been a delight to have you on the Portland Culinary Podcast. I love Healy Otera. I continue to celebrate your success, and I can't wait to go to your tasting room sometime in the next few years for an event and promote the heck out of it. And I wish you all the best and continued success.
Well, thank you so much for having me, Stephen. It's been a pleasure.
All right. Cheers, everyone.